as an educator, I'd like to give you guys 10 out of 10 for your engagement with the presentation. There are some fabulous questions that we're going to ask Joanna to have a go at. It's always tricky when you get put on the spot, isn't it? Okay. So just starting up, someone asked the question, how do the outcomes of your research affect your interactions with patients?
The main thing that's happened is that I've grown in my confidence about seeing patterns catching the things that I think most GPs learn on the job about this task of how to connect with the person as a person who's lost their dog or has something going wrong with their workplace at the same time that they've got dermatitis or something physical going on. And so what I've found is that I now have a way of understanding that work more carefully. So from taking someone from the waiting room to letting them choose which seat is it they're most comfortable with in my room, I now have a framework for describing why that was so important to me before and why I can teach it to the next generation of GPs so they don't have to learn it the slow way. I found when I've teach this to GPs say, you're describing what I do already, but I didn't have words to describe it. I've also found it as a way of validating links to established bodies of literature. So if we look at broad awareness, those who teach about mindfulness, that work would fit in here, but so would the work of those who research mentalization, which is the way that we teach reflective function in parenting, where a parent can attune into the needs of a child that are different to their own needs. Am I too close to the mic? Are you right?
Oh, sorry, it's just in
your face. Oh, okay. I'm shorter than you, I think. is that better? Feels a bit. So it's given me a framework to collect, like a bowerbird, good science from around the world that's got disconnected from each other. And bring it back together so that we can teach it in a more whole way. And I guess that it gives me a framework in my work too to watch for these patterns in my patients. That my main goal, for example, is to help someone feel capable to engage their world. And if giving them an antidepressant makes them feel that they are somehow defective because they're taking a tablet, then that's another good reason not to give it to them amongst the many reasons that there are not to give it. So for me, it's this wider reasoning that GPs have about how they make decisions with people that are not just about cure or the medical kind of prescription and referral that we're sometimes told that's all we do. So that's, I guess, to me, it's given me a sense of dignity in my work that I can teach as well.
This is a sort of a follow-up question to that, and it's around the challenge in terms of the time that you have as a GP to do this complex work and to deal with the financial challenges that exist there as well.
Yeah, so at the moment, our system highly values short consults in general practice, and it pays a GP better per hour if they do a short consult. That doesn't mean that's how GPs should define their work. That's just a Medicare rebate system that our community has grown to expect to be how much they get the rebate for each minute that they're in with the GP. And I've had to work this. I see it as the cost of doing whole person care that I don't do 10-minute appointments. And I probably never could, actually. I was always running late when I was trying to. And now I do 50-minute appointments in my work. And that's been a cost to my family, but it's also been a cost to those clinics where I've worked who take a percentage of my work. And they've borne that because they agree with the philosophy. And that's been, you know, from the beginning when I went to my GP boss and said, I want to do this work, I'll be doing longer consults, is that okay with you? He gave me his blessing. But that's not the case in all clinics. Some clinics, GPs are really pushed by their owners to put the work through. So I guess I would see this as a message for the people. If you want GPs to give you more time, we need the government to value it. If we want a rebate for that work. Yeah, and for GPs, it's about saying you need this time. So that's part of why I'm writing in the literature, my most recent one about the craft of journalism, saying is you need time to do this good work, and then we therefore need to advocate for policy change around that.
So that's one of the challenges that you have. A couple of people have identified a couple of other challenges and wondering how you deal with them. One is
In the world where data is king, how do you work against the pushback that you would get? And the other sort of pushback someone's identified is the fact that you are acknowledging the importance of spirit, and you know, how do people deal with that when it might not be seen to be politically correct or whatever it is?
Yeah, so both of those, data as king, I say, well, that's a certain kind of data that you're talking about, the capital E evidence kind of data, the narrow objectified kind of data. But there are other kinds of data, like the data that's in a story. We all know when we spend our lives trying to learn when we've heard a true story. And it's actually a skill set to work out when something's true or not. And the data that's in the relational sensing we have between us and someone else. And to know that as human beings, our whole bodies are sensing and sense-making at the same time. So they're collecting data from the senses, like what we see and hear and smell, and connecting it to our memories, connecting it to reason, connecting to what we already know, and sometimes making us curious about what we don't know. So that way of seeing data is, I guess, something that I champion. It does mean that I have to look for people who are older and wiser than me who are already doing this. And I've had to go overseas to find clinicians who are doing this work. So there's amazing GPs in Norway who've been researching multimorbidity. So they're showing that if someone has a sense of dissatisfaction with their life, even though they have no diseases when they first measure them, 10 years later they have more, what we call multimorbidity, more diseases at once. We critique the concept of multimorbidity because multimorbidity implies that for some reason in one person they seem to have more diseases than you'd expect by probability. I wonder if there might be something else going on is the question that they're asking. And so I found champions who are ahead of me, 10 years ahead of me in this space, who've been willing to write with me and think with me and encourage me. And so that's part of the way I've managed that pushback. The other part of it is to be basically know that I'm never going to make it to the top of any silo, and to start getting comfortable with this place where connections is the main important thing. In terms of spirit, there are beautiful people writing about spirit from a non-kind of religious space. People who work with grief and meaning have written in the literature in this space. And so I use the language meaning and spirit in order to cross that divide, that some people don't believe that we have a spirit, but they do understand the concept of meaning. And so if we speak about them in the same space, we can care for the people who have those different ways of seeing the world. Yeah, and that's then part of my reason is to enfranchise it in the literature so that then those who follow me can say, I'm not out on a limb, I'm not doing something a bit wacky or kind of quackery, that this is in some parts of the world's literature something that's considered highly valuable to understand about people.
I love that idea that you're doing translation for people to help them understand. Yeah. Mm. Someone's asked the question, what patterns can be identified in loss and grief?
There's some lovely Dutch researchers, Strobe and Schut, who have identified a pattern that happens in grieving that is a movement, it's a dynamic. So, of course, I'm a bit biased to noticing the dynamics. And so they say that when we grieve, we move between loss orientation and restoration orientation. And it's an oscillation backwards and forwards. And at the beginning, it's a very fast oscillation because we return to what we've lost over and over and over, but we still have some ordinary day-to-day tasks we must do. And so there's this movement backwards and forwards over time. And as time goes, that oscillation slows, but it will never stop. You know, so we return to what we've lost at different times in our lives. There's other things that trigger it to return to what we've lost. And so there's that movement to keeping on going, restoration and movement back to loss. And when we're caring for grief and loss, what we're concerned about is if someone's stuck at either end, so they're only able to see the loss or they're only able to do restoration tasks and they're not adapting to knowing what they've lost. Sometimes they get stuck in the middle in a kind of paralyzed space as well. But we're watching, trying to help them to do that movement backwards and forwards as a natural thing that human beings do when they grieve. When I do my work with trauma, I see that my main job is to get them to feel safe enough to grieve. Yeah, and once they feel safe enough, they can do the grieving on their own. They don't need to be doing fancy processing. Their bodies will process what they know has really happened to them once they feel safe enough. Yeah.
That leads well into this next question. I'm going to read what this person has said. They said, "Thank you for your great talk, Joanna. My question relates to any suggestions you might have as to how any or all of us can take a next step in helping to build this sense of safety with others in this fully holistic way in our own spaces."
So I invite you to use the language. When I did the research, I noticed as one of the research findings that participants actually naturally started using the word safety. They'd say, "I feel safe in this group," in the focus group. And so it's a natural language. It's part of our ordinary lexicon. It's been tested by the generations before us to mean something. And it's something we understand across people. It's something that we generally understand. We mean the same things when we say it. And so to have that in the back of your mind as something you're trying to do wherever you are in your workplace, with your colleagues, with the people you care for, and to think this broad view, what's going on in their environment, what's going on in their relationships, how is their body going? We've lost some of the practical skills about helping bodies calm down. We make little children sit still in chairs in school, and when we should be sending them out to let off a bit of steam to calm their bodies down. And I think some schools and places have already know this, of course. But that sense of your own body, learning how to sense your own body. And so we use this to teach GPs. There's a little framework on my website if you want to think through how to calm your own body. And I'm about to put one up there that was made during COVID as well. So those are resources you're welcome to use as well.
How do people survive thousands of years ago when they did not have all this research on emotional well-being?
I think they were experts at pattern recognition. Yeah, I think we've just de-skilled ourselves and we've professionalised the space of ill health and distress in our community. We've handed it over to professionals. We've allowed them to tell us what's true and what's not true, even though our guts can see something different. And so this piece about pattern recognition is a beautiful human skill. That's why I hope you'll leave here excited about it.
And it wouldn't be Theology on Tap without this final question. How did all your discoveries impact on your understanding of God?
I guess for me this is about deep belonging. It's about seeing that sense of safety is something that God cares about. Over and over in the scriptures, he talks about do not fear. He also talks about being our refuge and our safe place, our hiding place, a place we can hide under those wings. So for me, it's been a deep motivation for my research, actually. It's been like the ancient scriptures that tell us of how God wants to talk to people have given me a little insight that made me brave enough to go back to the academy and look for something that they weren't looking for. And so it's like secret knowledge, secret wisdom, that I went in ahead of time knowing because it had meant something to me, had given me belonging in my own journey, and a place of being in the borderlands. He's with us in the borderlands, whatever your borderlands are.
Joanna, would you like to tell everyone a little bit about your book and where they might find it if they're interested in it?
Somebody's got it in the crowd at the moment. You want to just hold it up? Just hold it up. It is available in UQ Library and the Royal College of GPs Library. It's still really expensive because it's priced by the publisher for libraries. But if you want it, it's on discount. There's a discount code on my website. It'll be coming out in paperback in June. And I will let Theology on Tap know about it when it does. I guess I would say it's a little bit of a funner version than the PhD, which you can also get on the UK. It's got a few stories in it, patient stories with their permission. I guess for me, I hope it would encourage you in your journey of wholeness.
And two questions to finish up with. One is, what are you enjoying in your work at the moment, and what are you looking forward to?
Oh, okay. So I'm getting to talk to mental health nurses on Friday, so I'm enjoying preparing myself for speaking with them, because I think of them as generalists as well, who are right on the ground with people. So I'm preparing for that talk and enjoying thinking about the unique role of nurses in the world. And I've become a bit of a bowerbird for other professions that think in systems. So encouraging them to think of their work as sophisticated knowledge management that's bringing together the more objective and the subjective ways of knowing at once. And so I see teachers in that space, I see social workers in that space, I see pastors in that space, and I'm sure there's more for me. Physios have been in that space as well. I'm sure those of you who are in the crowd are in a profession where you see it as generalism. I'd love to hear from you too. But this is a place where we can become proud of the skill of holding the whole rather than ashamed of being the one that doesn't know the specialised skill.